must constantly look at things in a different way.
The Healthcare Education Transformation Podcast was created by two physical therapists out of the desire to learn more about the different educational roles in physical therapy and healthcare, and how healthcare education works by talking with educational leaders and people with different perspectives within physical therapy and across interdisciplinary lines on how education can be improved to disrupt the status quo of healthcare education. This is our journey, and thanks for listening. Are you a third-year physical therapy student that excels on tests when you have study guides, checklists, and deadlines? With all of the information available about how to prepare for the NPTE, it's easy to get disorganized and not feel prepared going into the big day. NPTE Prep Success is an online course that provides PT students easy-to-use study guides and step-by-step guidance through the NPTE preparation. To learn more, visit kylericeprep.com. Thank you again all for your continued support, and now for the show.
All right. So, hey, everybody. This is obviously not Brandon, F. Scott, or Stephanie, but my name is Jason Yore, and if you guys didn't realize, I'm a guest host for this episode. Brandon was nice enough to allow me to come on. I have a special interest in tendinopathy treatment and management, and so he allowed me to come on and speak with Dr. Jill Cook. If you don't know, she's one of the most renowned researchers in tendinopathy. And so I just want to say thank you, Jill, for coming on today.
My pleasure. It's a delight to be here.
Great. So I want to say again, thanks so much for all the work you've done in the field. It's made a huge impact on me clinically, and I'm sure I'm not the only one, obviously. If you wouldn't mind, I'd love if you could go over a little bit of your background and how you got to this point in your academic career.
Sure. I obviously am a physiotherapist and fell into basketball and became involved with the national teams and some sort of our national league here, and had people with patellar tendon that had no strategies. I had nothing in the literature. So I started to do some research, and before I knew it, had finished my PhD and have just moved on from there. So it was always very clinically driven, my interest in research, and it remains that. Everything we do aims to deliver better clinical outcomes, basically.
Well, awesome. Great. So when Brennan came to me with this idea to come on the show, I kind of thought it would be a good idea to go over tendinopathy management kind of from the beginning to end, somewhat of a historical perspective, maybe going over kind of how our narratives have changed over time. Yep. And so I thought it'd be a great idea to kind of start with the progression of tendon pathology and what may lead to these problems initially.
Yeah, well, it's a really interesting place to start because I think there's about 7 models that propose how tendons become pathological. What we know a lot about the normal tendon, and we know a lot about end-stage pathology, the degenerative tendon pathology. What we don't know is very much in between, and it seems that we'll never really agree, and I think it's going to be very hard for us ever to have good evidence about how tendons do progress from normal to degenerative pathology. However, you know, we proposed the continuum theory, and we've updated that twice. I firmly believe we're right, and we published it in 2009. And I haven't seen any research yet that suggests that it's not true. Nobody's actually come up with anything that doesn't support what we see or what we propose in the continuum model. And of course, I like it because it makes sense from a clinical perspective as well. We can really deliver treatments targeted to what we think is actually happening in the tendon.
Okay. And for those who may not have read those papers back in 2009, or I know there was an updated one in 2016. Yep. So for anybody that's not familiar with that model, would you mind diving into that a little bit?
Sure. So what we propose is that it's a cell-driven pathology. So we know that the tendon cells are fairly indolent. They're attached very much to the matrix and are very sensitive to the load. So if we overload a tendon, we know that we can't tear the collagen because you can't tear normal collagen. So there has to be something else that starts the process of change within the tendon. So what we propose is the overload stimulates the tendon cell. We know, as I said, it can respond, and that the tendon cell will respond to the load by protecting itself and producing proteoglycans or ground substance, whatever you want to call it, which is sort of a water-absorbing sponge, if you want to look at it from that perspective. That helps protect the cell, but also starts to disrupt the collagen matrix. And the longer that process goes on, the more and more disruption of the matrix we see, and eventually we get to a degenerative pathology.
Okay, interesting. Now, earlier this year, you did come out with a paper as well, and I want to say that was in the Journal of Applied Physiology, where you talk about the role interfascicular sliding may have in this process as well. Did you want to kind of expand on that?
Well, yeah, this is a pretty deep dive into a new way of thinking. I love this new concept. So Hazel Screen is a biomedical engineer, and she's shown that in energy storage and release tendons, the ones that we have pathology in and tendinopathy in, you don't get much change in fascicle length. What you get is a slide between the fascicles, and that there's a connective tissue, we used to call it endotendon, it's now called interfascicular matrix. The endotendon or interfascicular matrix absorbs a lot of the loading by sliding and rotating when the tendon stores and releases energy. Now, what we know about the cells, and it comes back to the cells always, the cells in that part of the tendon, in the connective tissue, are very responsive and very different to the intrafascicular cells. Now, what we propose is that the reactive tendon stage that we thought occurred in the within the fascicle actually now we think occurs within the interfascicular matrix. So too much sliding and gliding, too much energy storage and release, the clinical presentation of tendon pain and pathology causes the interfascicular matrix to react. We see swelling, which is the reactive tendon. But if we keep loading it too much, we'll actually break down this interfascicular matrix and we'll put load on the fascicles, which is the start of the non-repairable or non-reversible tendon pathology. Now, that's really complex for people who perhaps don't know that. That's tendon structure and tendon pathology to that extent. Man, I'm excited about it because all of a sudden it makes complete sense about the clinical presentation. It puts reactive tendon clearly on the map. It actually helps address inflammation because we know that you can get inflammatory cells and inflammatory mediators in the interfascicular matrix, and people talk about there being these markers in tendon pathology. All of a sudden, it's another big step forward in our understanding. Again, proving it may be difficult.
Yeah, no, that's great. And so I've read a little bit about that before. I've seen a lot of work from, I think her name is Thorpe. She's done a lot of that.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Yeah. And it's fascinating. But one of the big takeaways I took was I didn't know exactly where that would lead us clinically in terms of management. Do you think there's anything that has implications for us as, you know, clinicians who primarily deal with load, or is this going to be something more kind of pharmaceutical, maybe more surgical?
It's definitely not surgical and probably not pharmaceutical. Clinically, it fits in with what we already do. We know that too much energy storage and too many energy storage and release loads create problems in our tendon and can be pain and can be pathology. When we do manage tendons, we manage them from a load perspective. So what we're really doing is saying, you can't slide and glide these tendon fascicles forever or repeatedly because they just don't cope. Therefore, we have to change how we slide and glide or how much we slide and glide these fascicles to actually have some sort of impact on the progression of the disease or the progression of the pain. Now, there's so many complications with that because people go through this process without ever having pain. And so people can have a degenerative tendon pathology and have never had pain. But if we think about the reactive on degenerative tendon pathology, which I think is the most common, where you have an area of degeneration that's probably non-mechanically responsive and you have the normal part of the tendon surrounding it, it's probably still very relevant that we address too many loads on that normal part of the tendon by controlling what that person does. So I think, I'm not sure, there's so many levels to this, it's very hard to make it a simple statement, but clinical management of loads is the answer for tendons.
Gotcha. Nice. No, I definitely agree. I find that to be very interesting.
Yeah, Jill, I just have one follow-up question for you there. Like, obviously, this is some pretty brilliant work, and it's pretty complex, but how are you taking this information and educating athletes about it and what they need to be doing?
I think we have to stay out of that rabbit hole. There's not many athletes that can really take the depth of understanding, depth of knowledge that we're talking about here. What we have to do is really just educate them about load, that this is what happens in your tendon when you do this type of activity. If you do too much of it, this we have a response in the tendon. The tendon tells you that it doesn't like it, which it will clearly do with pain, and therefore we have to reduce the loads. We can't get more complex than that with the athlete, but I think as a clinician, we have to truly understand what we're telling that athlete and why we're telling them. I think if you don't understand what you're talking about and you suggest that the person rests, then you're going to get it wrong, because rest is not the right treatment. It's about changing the loads that are creating the pathology and the pain in the first place. So I think as a clinician, you have to understand it, but I don't think you can fully present it to the athlete.
No, great. Yeah. I mean, I'd argue too, a lot of clinicians probably don't even want to take that far of a dive.
Yeah, I would agree. You know, I've been talking, I won't tell you how many years, but a lot of years about tendons and tendon pathology. And I'm constantly amazed at how little people can take on, and clinicians I'm talking about here are willing to take on and can take on. It's the rare person like yourself who really does get excited about it and really does want to understand. So I think not only do we have to sell a simple message to the athletes, we have to sell a simple message to the clinicians as well.
Oh, absolutely. Especially if we're looking to change practice, it's got to be somewhat of a straightforward presentation, right?
Yeah. But the caveat on that for me is I'm so over recipe management of tendons. Mm-hmm. And we have to be so careful. We empower the clinician to make good clinical decision-making, exercise-based rehabilitation, because give a clinician a recipe and they'll go with it regardless of whether it's the right thing or not. And so that balance between sort of some didactic type of reasoning and some good clinical reasoning is very hard.
Absolutely. So I kind of want to take it back. So we've used the word overload quite a bit, and you mentioned the big red flag is not letting people completely rest tendons because that's not a good viable option, right? So I've also seen arguments, and I want to say this was Arnofsky, if I'm saying that right, back in 2007, where he wrote this paper talking about how dangerous underloading and understimulation of tendinitis can be for tendon pathology.
Yes.
Is that still hold up? Is that still known to be valid?
Absolutely. The joy of underloading or resting too much, it has a pathological implication, but it has clinical implications as well. So we can make a really good argument for it. What we know is if you completely unload a tendon, it turns pathological. It has to have load to maintain a structure. And that's been shown by Arnofsky, and it's been shown by in many animal studies. We don't see that many good human studies. But what we know is if you bed rest somebody, within 2 weeks, you've completely destroyed the mechanical strength of the tendon. So if you rest them completely, you can become pathological. If you rest them somewhat, they actually lose mechanical stiffness in the tendon. So we know clearly what's happening in the tendon, but the clinician will understand if you rest them, you lose muscle strength, you lose kinetic chain capacity. And, you know, Ebony Rio's work shows that we probably lose motor drive as well. So it's a fantastic sort of comprehensive argument that the tendon is affected at a sort of cellular, molecular, you know, matrix level, but the clinician can really appreciate the rest is not going to help the rest of the kinetic chain as well.
Okay, awesome. And so when I was talking with a friend about this, his main question that he wanted me to pose was, is there any indication that there can be some prophylactic or preventative measures of resistance training to build up tendon structure prior to the initiation of any of these events?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And I don't think we have the research to really tell us that that's true. But sort of reverse engineering would sort of tell us that's true. We know if you do a lot of strength work, and that's what we do when we rehab tendons, is that that seems to control pain and it seems to restore function. What we know if we don't have a strong muscle tendon unit and we don't do our strength loading, that we lose the stiffness in the tendon. So it makes sense for me, and this is what we preach clinically, is you have to stay strong. So if we treat somebody with a tendinopathy and we rehab them and they get back to their sport, we keep them on a strength program for at least 12 to 18 months and often advocate that they stay on a strength program for the rest of their career, because it seems that that gives us our best prevention. The studies that have tried the eccentric loading, there's been two, the Fredberg study and the business study in season, so trying to get people to do eccentrics in season to prevent tendon pain, I guess, were both a failure. So it seems that you can't load the spring, you can't do the interfascicular sliding and gliding. That doesn't seem to give us anything, but it's the slow, heavy stuff that seems to give us the muscle strength and the mechanical strength in the tendon.
And I definitely want to dive back into that in a little bit too.
Yeah.
That is a whole nother rabbit hole to go down. I want to stay on the topic of some implications for tendon pathology just for a minute. And one of the biggest things that the pendulum has kind of swung back and forth on that you somewhat talked about earlier was the role inflammation plays in tendinopathy. Obviously, back in the day, the designation itis versus osis, so it was thought to be pretty important. And we had a radical shift away from that. And then there have been a couple arguments lately. Like, I know there was a systematic review in 2017 by Dean, and then there was one in 2018 where they talked about this may be more of a definitional problem than it is there or is there not inflammation? Where initially we didn't see things like neutrophils in the area, so we kind of concluded there wasn't any inflammation, but now they see kind of on a molecular level, there's more monocyte and macrophage and other cytokines. So like, is there any way we can kind of unmuddy the water on this to see where we stand when it comes to inflammation in tendon?
Yeah. I have very strong views on this, and perhaps not as based in science as philosophy, I guess, but, you know, I'll share them with you anyway. So I'm old enough to remember when we did treat tendons from an inflammatory perspective. We rested them and iced them and anti-inflamed them, and we got no one better. You know, I can't imagine how many athletic careers I destroyed in the 80s and early 90s with that sort of approach. So I think for me, that starting place clearly tells me that inflammation's not the primary driver of either the pain or the pathology. And addressing inflammation doesn't help us with our athlete or our person with tendon pathology or tendon pain. But it's injured tissue. It's definitely going to have inflammation. There's no doubt that there is. It's just a question of what role it plays. And if you look at things like your inflammatory mediators, you know, your TNF-alphas and stuff like that, they often talk about it being upregulated by a factor of 2 or 3, sometimes 5. But when you have true inflammation, that can be upregulated 10,000 times. And so the mediators are there. The cells are there. They're in very low numbers and low amounts, and they're a response to injured tissue. And I have no issues with the fact that it exists. It's just not anything that we need to worry about. Now, the beauty of this new interfascicular matrix sliding and gliding is if we do excess sliding and gliding, we have vessels and we have nerves in the interfascicular matrix. So we have a perfect opportunity for an increase in inflammation in that space. But again, I think it's still relatively a response rather than an absolute inflammatory response, I guess, to you know, the excess movement in the tendon. So a couple of other things I can add to that, and I can talk about this for ages, is most of the cells that are the inflammatory cells are there perivascular. So what happens is they sit around the blood vessel. So they pop out, have a look around, make sure everything's okay, can't really do anything, and then they will often go back into the vessel. So they're not really contributing in an active way to the process. And the last thing on that, is we don't have, the way that you get inflammation in tendons is to lacerate it. So you have to bleed a tendon to get an inflammatory proliferative maturative response. Cut your skin, you get that response and you get scarring. In an overused tendon pathology, we don't have that response because we don't have a bleed in the tendon. It's the bleed that initiates that process. And so if we want that process, and sometimes in rarely in tendons we do, then that's what we have to do. We lacerate the tendon in some way, surgically or, you know, with scalpel or something. And that will really give us inflammation. But overused tendon pathology doesn't have that response, and it will have inflammation, but it's not an active driving response to pathology or pain.
Okay, great. Thank you. You know, that definitely helps clear that up a little bit. And it actually leads into kind of the next set of questions I had, which is kind of looking at more vascular implications. Just because there was an interesting study that came out earlier this year in AJSM by Wesenbeek, I want to say the name is.
Wesenbeek,
yeah. Thank you. But they looked at kind of the role of the vascular and structural response to activity in the development of Achilles tendinopathy. And they prospectively followed a bunch of runners, and they evaluated the blood flow response after running. And for those listening, what they found was that they showed that for those who went on to develop symptoms, they actually showed a lower increase in blood flow increase, if I hope I said that right, they showed a lower increase in blood flow after running, and that was correlated with a higher hazard of developing the symptoms later on. Now, the only reason I bring this up is because a justification a lot of people have when they use interventions like manual techniques or like, say, trigger point dry needling or some other interventions is that they use blood flow as a justification for their inclusion. Now, is that merited at all? Is there any indication that we have an appreciable effect on blood flow mechanics in or out of the tendon?
Gosh, again, another onion for this one. The first thing is that it appears that it really doesn't matter what we do to a tendon. If it's got a degenerative pathology in it, we won't change the pathology. It's an irreversible condition. It's mechanically insensitive. That is, when you load the tendon, the area of pathology will not take load. It can't take load because it has no collagen structure. So the first thing will be, I don't get that we have to change the pathology. We can have a massive degenerative pathology and have a perfectly functional tendon. So why we'd be wanting to change that in the first place, I don't get. I don't understand that. The second thing is that the vascularity really is opportunistic. So in the continuum model, what we propose is that the vessels are the last thing to arrive. There's evidence in the lateral elbow that if you have vascularity, that the repair around the vessel isn't any better than the repair distant to the vessel. So it doesn't appear to be a reparative type of vascularity. There's evidence that the vascularity actually can be so thick-walled that it actually can't take blood. So you actually, it's just a structure rather than something that's actually functional. So there's a lot of things to suggest that the vascularity is not a response to the pathology. It's opportunistic. Now, there's a study by Donald Inber in cardiovascular literature that shows that if you have an intact matrix, you restrict the endothelium of the vessel. Now, as soon as you disrupt the matrix, the endothelium of the vessel will actually bud into the hole or the area that's not constrained. So it's quite possible that tendon vascularity is just there because the tendon matrix is broken down, the collagen matrix is broken down. And that would be consistent with what we see clinically. And clinically, we use this. If we see a lot of vessels, we know it's degenerative and we know we're never going to change it. So I can't see why we would be bothering with aiming anything at the vascularity that's probably there just because it can be and not because it's doing anything of value. And B, we're not going to change the pathology anyway. So why the heck are we bothering with that as well? So, it doesn't make much sense to me.
No, that's great. That's great. And so with that, I understand we're not going to be able to change the pathology. That's definitely an area I wanted to dive into. So I guess I'll go ahead and do that. You and Sean Docking came out with a couple papers, and you've kind of coined a term or phrase, the treat the donut, not the whole. Did you want to expand on that a little bit and kind of dive in on that aspect of tendon management?
Yeah. And again, I think this is some research that's really changed our clinical practice a lot. So Sean did a series of UTC imaging, which is an ultrasound algorithmic enhanced sort of ultrasound, if you want to look at it from that perspective. And what we can measure is aligned fibrillar structure, so aligned collagen and disorganized collagen. So we can actually sort of split the tendon into pathology, where there is no collagen or no aligned collagen, and relatively normal tendon, where the collagen is aligned. And what he showed was that if you have an area of pathology in your tendon, you actually have sufficient aligned structure, that is sufficient normal tendon, if you want to put it in inverted commas. And in fact, you have as much as somebody who has a normal tendon. So what we often think of in a pathological tendon is it must be weaker. We have to be careful. It's got an area of pathology. We can't load it. We have to do something about the pathology because it's all very bad. It's a patho-anatomical approach to injury and pathology. Sean's study showed that's not true. Yes, you have pathology, but you actually have a thicker tendon and you actually have enough or more good tissue that we can load. And that has really changed our education to our patients. So people will come in with lumpy, bumpy tendons and it's a very thick tendon. And, you know, the natural response is, oh, my goodness, you have a lot of pathology. Our response to these patients now is, my goodness, look how thick it is. Isn't that wonderful? You have great tissue here we can work with. And there's a lot of new stuff about kinesiophobia and how we frighten patients. And, you know, our outcomes are really derived from the education we give and the messages we give. We have to be so careful about the messages we give, and we're not very good in tendons yet at being positive about tendon pathology, which I think we can be now based on Sean's work.
Yeah, great. So when you talk about kind of loading the remaining viable collagen structures around the area of degeneration, what do you think is actually occurring? What adaptations are we actually facilitating? Because there have been a lot of studies, you know, mostly in the same direction where they show there's no change, observable change, at least on the level we're examining, in the tendon structure, and it's not correlated at all with the outcomes we observe. So yep. What may be going on behind the scenes with our loading interventions?
And this is, again, something that's evolving in my brain. I always used to say I treated the tendon. We're going to rehabilitate you, and I'm going to treat your tendon and make it not healthy, but we're going to improve the situation. Realistically, we change the mechanical strength in the tendon. We change the muscle strength. We change the strength in the kinetic chain, and we change the motor drive. Now, which of those has the greatest effect on people's restoration of function and resolution of pain? I haven't got a clue. And so now I tend to be very careful about what I say in terms of not only affecting the tendon. I think we do. And there's really good evidence that we get more mechanically stiff. Where that happens, I actually sent an email around a couple of years ago saying, okay, we get mechanically stiffer when we load tendons. Where does this occur in the tendon? And there wasn't a person in the world that could answer that. So logically, it happens in the interfascicular matrix. Okay, if it's stiffer, you would think that's sliding and gliding less. But the answer is, it doesn't appear to, or we don't have the evidence for it. And the evidence also is that plyometrics don't change mechanical strength of tendons. It's the slow, heavy loading that seems to do that. So the next sort of thought bubble in my brain is maybe when we load tendons, we change the fascicular stiffness, not the interfascicular stiffness. And that's what gives us our change in mechanical strength. That's what happens when we rehabilitate somebody. That's the tendon adaptation. Now, I don't have any evidence for that. Talking to Hazel Screen, she's trying to look at what happens to the interfascicular matrix when you load them and after rehabilitation. about, but I think we're way off from really understanding it. But if I was to have a punt, I wonder if the changes are in within the fascicle themselves rather than the interfascicular matrix. Again, another rabbit hole. You know, all you've done is lead me down rabbit holes so far.
I greatly apologize for that. And so I just want to clarify this for anybody listening. So when you say mechanical changes, usually when tendons get talked about, they break it down into morphological changes, like our tendon hypertrophy and cross-sectional area, and then mechanical changes. And by that, we mean the stiffness or how much it deforms per unit of stress, correct?
Yes.
And so just because I guess I'm going to get on your nerves today, I've seen a lot of controversy surrounding the adaptations that occur within even the changes of stiffness within tendons. And this may even matter depending on the tendon type and the location. Yeah. Because there have been a few studies in the past 2 years, and I'm just trying to make sure I get the names right here, so one in 2017 by Combs, where they use shear wave velocity to kind of as a proxy for the elastic modulus or somewhat of stiffness, where they show divergent responses between the patellar tendon and the Achilles tendon. And then there was another one, and this was by Obst, O-B-S-T. I'm butchering names today. And this was in Sports Medicine, where they look at the differences in Achilles and patellar tendinopathy, and they see that stereotypical change when it comes to Achilles tendinopathy, where they see a reduction in stiffness with the degenerative condition. But in patellar tendinopathy, they didn't really even find any difference in tensile behavior. So is this something that's still emerging? Is this still something that we don't have clear evidence on? Or is this something that is maybe just not enough data yet and it'll be cleared up?
Oh, nothing's ever cleared up in tendons. That's the first thing. Abandon that. Okay. So I think the jury's still out on the value of elastography. And it doesn't really matter how many papers you read on this. We're getting such diverse outcomes and results from elastography. So I am not going to put anything on that or on the results from that until I'm clear that it is actually demonstrating something in the tendon that's worthwhile. So if we pack away elastography, there's a whole range of issues with measuring tendon stiffness in people with tendinopathy because so many of the studies are done in people with pain. And pain causes unloading. Unloading causes loss of stiffness. And so then there's a conflation of pain and pathology where they say, oh, well, pathology causes loss of stiffness. No, it doesn't. Well, not that we know of. It's the pain that causes the unloading that causes a loss of stiffness, and you actually have the pathology. So we need better studies where we compare people with pain and pathology to people with pathology and no pain, because that's the only way we're going to work out whether pathology makes you more stiff or less stiff. And there is one coming out in very soon, I hope, that I can't talk about yet, but there will be a study where we looked at people with pain pathology, people with pathology only, and normal tendons, and showed that pain does accentuate the issues of unloading and loss of stiffness. So elastography, I'm not a great believer in. I don't think the studies have been done yet truly to say what happens with loading to a pathological tendon, whether it's stiffer or not. The differences between the patellar tendon and the Achilles tendon are just so enormous, even before we start to think about pathology. You know, when I started this, it was like tendons are tendons are tendons are tendon. Who cares where it is? The answer is that is so not true. It's another rabbit hole. You know, if you think about the Achilles is the only tendon that fails in the mid-tendon. Every other tendon that we have fails at the bone-tendon junction. So immediately they're different. And then you have a patellar tendon that only fails in young jumping men, whereas the Achilles tendon fails us across our lifespan. It's affected by less affected by gender, whereas the patellar tendon is much more affected by gender. And there's a whole new group of studies that we've done to look at how the patellar tendon develops. So, you know, I don't think you can take findings from one tendon and then just say, well, this is what happens in tendons. So I think we just need much more targeted research. We need to build a block of research in one tendon that clarifies that, and then try in a different tendon and see if we can clarify what's happening. The other thing that's really important is that once you post puberty, it appears that you don't change your structural dimensions, that there is nothing that stimulates a change in, you can't make a tendon bigger and in, you know, as part of that stronger in inverted commas by forming new tissue. You change mechanical strength in tendons once you're an adult. Now that's different to the donut and the hole, because the pathology seems somehow to stimulate the addition of new tissue. And how that happens, we haven't got any idea. So I haven't answered that question very well, but I just don't know how we can. We just need to be a bit more systematic about how we approach the research and just have to build a wall of evidence rather than bits and pieces and try and put it all together in one story that makes sense in every tendon, in every age group, in every gender, in every loading environment, people with pain, people with pathology, people, you know, the whole thing is so much more complex than trying to generalize from one piece of research.
No, that's great advice. Absolutely. And so taking that and kind of trying to create somewhat of a digestible narrative for somebody to take home with. So when it comes to the treat the donut, not the hole expression, are you convinced that we're having an impact on the collagen structure, like the immature collagen that is in the degenerative tendon, or are we mostly just going to back away from that narrative and talk about, we know there's a positive effect of loading these structures. We may not know what it is. We're probably having an impact on the mechanical side of things, but even that's kind of a toss-up.
Yeah. I think there's two things. The first thing is we probably don't change the pathology because it's mechanically insensitive. It can't take load. We must have load to change a tendon. And if the tendon can't, that part of the tendon can't take load or doesn't detect load, it can't change. So I don't think we're changing the pathology. Logically, we should be with load changing the mechanical strength of the remaining normal tendon, and there seems to be plenty of it. So I would have some confidence that we can improve the mechanical properties of a pathological tendon, but we do it in the area of the normal tendon, not in the area of pathology. But the caveat on that is we improve the muscle, as I said, the kinetic chain, we improve the motor drive, we change so many things that I don't know what percentage that change in the tendon offers us, whether it's 20% of the overall improvement or 90% of the overall improvement. I just think we haven't got a clue where we have our maximum effect. What we do know is if we treat all of those things, we get a very positive outcome. And I think we just have to be honest with ourselves that we actually don't know what the hell we're doing most of the time.
Yeah, that's a good takeaway right there. You know, when I was looking over studies to try to have this conversation, I ran across one that really caught my interest. And you alluded to the initial study, the carbon dating study by Hennemeyer back in 2013, I want to say that was, and that we don't see any evidence of, you know, the collagen proper changing over time. Mm-hmm. But I saw they released, that same group released another study this year where they actually showed a little bit different interpretation of some data, where their takeaway was that about half of the collagen matrix may be undergoing years of continuous but slow renewal, and that renewal may kind of precede the symptomatic presentation in tendinopathy. And they're saying they have a lot of, you know, just conjecture basically based on that, but they speculate that it may be a prerequisite for developing tendinopathy, and it may be something we can kind of see as a long-term pathological development. Do you have any thoughts on that? I don't know if you've gotten a chance to read that paper yet. Or
yeah, you know, it's really interesting. We've known for a very long time that pathology predates symptoms. I don't think that's anything spectacular or new. So, you know, a goodly percentage of the population is developing pathology. And once you're developing pathology, you are turning over collagen tissue. You have to, because you're degrading type 1 and you're making type 2 and type 3. So that can be all occurring in a whole group of people all of the time, some of whom may or may not become pathological. So that the classic Canis and Yoza paper showed 66% of people who had profound tendon pathology had never had a symptom in their life. So the concept that that's occurring isn't new to me. I have no issues with that. It's how we use that clinically, because people present with pain. They're not presenting with a new pathology. The pathology has probably been there for years, and something they've done has created the pain, the overload in the normal part of the tissue. That's how you want to look at it. So I think that gives us a molecular matrix level understanding of what we know happens. But I don't think it's anything new. The other thing that I think is really important, and this is a bit more of a rabbit hole, is that the tendon cells, even in a normal tendon, will make collagen. They make collagen and they make proteoglycans, but they then immediately degrade it. So little of the collagen that's made is actually integrated into the matrix. It's just a process of the tendon cell keeping itself active, saying, yes, I can still make collagen, I can still make proteoglycans, and then they just immediately dispose of it. It's just degraded. Now, you can measure both the manufacture of that collagen and the degradation of that collagen. What you can't measure is if it's integrated into the matrix or not. And I think that collagen turnover occurs very naturally in normal tendons and in a lot more probably in pathological tendons. John Parkinson showed that the metabolic rate of a pathological tendon was 25 times higher than a normal tendon. A normal tendon will sit there and, you know, very slowly make and break down things. Pathological tendon cell will just keep manufacturing and degrading things at a great rate or not. But doesn't actually go anywhere. It doesn't actually make new structure. It doesn't make new matrix. So you can measure all these things till you're blue in the face, but it doesn't actually help you decide whether you're actually making the matrix better. Because to integrate collagen into a matrix, you need a normal tendon cell. It's all controlled by the cell. This is Elizabeth Canty's work. It's fibropositors. If you don't have a normal cell, you will not integrate collagen into the matrix. And we know in pathology, you don't have a normal tendon cell. So that's a massive rabbit hole. And I don't know that I've got myself, I haven't got my head around it properly.
No, that's awesome. Because, yeah, a lot of time I've seen people kind of get excessively excited on social media where they'll throw up a surrogate outcome like, look, we increase protein synthesis X%. And it's like, obviously, you know, that's cool, I guess, but there's no evidence that that's being used for anything meaningful, especially when you contrast that with data showing no structural change and its lack of correlation with outcomes, right?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, I'm on the record many times of saying, what is the point of supplementing collagen to people with a tendon problem? It just doesn't make any sense. We've got so many amino acids available to us. We have a very small lesion when we're talking about tendon pathology. It's not a question of do we make enough collagen. We make plenty of collagen. We just make type 2 and type 3 collagen, and we don't integrate it into the matrix. So having more collagen supplementation is not going to change the process, because the process has been diverted because of the structure of the cell and the morphology of the cell. So, yeah, just to really annoy people who like collagen supplementation a bit more.
Yeah, I think I've seen you and Dr. Keith Barr scrimmage over that on Twitter before.
Yep, go ahead.
So along those lines, anybody kind of pushing nutritional interventions like, say, protein supplementation or anything like that to enhance healing intended pathologies, that doesn't seem to have any merit?
I just don't get it. If I cut my hand and, you know, if I had a 1 centimeter cut in my hand and I suddenly had to go and supplement myself to get that to repair, I'd be in pretty dire nutritional state. You know, I have plenty of capacity to repair that cut. That's the sort of size we're talking about. And if I cut my hand, I have an inflammatory proliferative maturative response because I've had a bleed. Okay, so we have all of the scar tissue, we have the process in place. in an overused tendon pathology, we don't have any of that process. The tendon cells are just sitting there going, whatever. You know, they're just so not activated by anything. So I cannot see, it makes absolutely no sense to me that any sort of supplementation will make any sort of difference in tendons. Add to that the Heinemeier stuff that suggests that you don't become structurally different after puberty, and taking into account the fact you can develop pathology, it just makes no sense to me.
No, I'm with you. That I'm just glad to get you on record on that one again.
That will cost me a Twitter fight or three.
So on that same topic of lack of change within the degenerative area, what role do you find biologics may have in management of tendinopathy?
I can talk clinically. I can talk a little bit of the evidence. I've just finished a review on autologous blood PRP. Really doesn't have any effect, but bottom line, you know, can have some short-term effects, but really doesn't change very much in the long term. But I want to go a step further back than that and say, if we think the pathology doesn't change and it doesn't have a capacity to change, and if we think we have enough normal tissue, why the dickens are we trying to change the pathology? We don't have to. There are thousands of athletes out there competing at elite level with horrible tendon pathology. They have no pain. They are perfectly functional. It's this patho-anatomical perspective, is it has to be normal to be functional. The answer is it doesn't have to be normal to be functional. We know that in low back pain. We know that in OA hip. We know that in OA knee, that you can have a perfectly functional and pain-free structure that's pathological at the same time. So at so many levels, the evidence isn't there to support biologicals. Stem cells are not integrated into the matrix. They don't whiz in and suddenly make everything perfectly normal. You know, they immunomodulate. You can immunomodulate with corticosteroid if that's what you need to do. There's nothing logical about it. I can't see the underlying reason why you would do it, and I don't think the evidence is there for it. I think that it's perceived as a quick fix. Everyone's looking for a quick fix. I think, and again, a Twitter fight or three coming up here, it makes people a lot of money, but it really doesn't service anything in terms of long-term outcome for these athletes, for these patients.
All right, great.
Was I clear?
I took a message away from it. It worked for me. So a couple more things I wanted to talk about. I'll backtrack a little bit. So we've gone over a lot of mechanical variables that may play a role in the development and propagation of tendon pathology, but there's been some studies on other things that may impact it. So like I know Kareem Khan, Desai earlier this year came out with a study showing that there was a negative correlation between BMI and Achilles tendon structure. There was another study that came out, Collins in 2018, when they were looking at factors like metabolic disorders and obesity and the correlation with AGEs or advanced glycation end products.
Yep.
And that's role in tendinopathy. So what can some of these factors that may not be mechanical play in the process?
Yeah, it's really interesting, and we don't know very much about it. So there's a definite role in tendon pain pathology. I don't think we know. Yes, we do. So Tom Ranger did a great systematic review in BJSM on diabetes and tendinopathy, and people with diabetes are more likely to have tendon pathology and tendon pain. People with tendon pain and pathology are much more likely to have diabetes. So there's a relationship there. Same with cholesterol and same with obesity. So that was Jamie Gaeter's work. The cholesterol was Ben Tilley's work. There's something going on. Now, what it is, I don't think we know. We know that central obesity, which is associated with diabetes, has a systemic inflammatory response. And when we're talking inflammatory here, we're not talking inflammation, proliferation, maturation. We're talking a generalized low-grade inflammatory body-wide response. That could be a factor. It does increase your AGEs. That seems to stiffen tendons. But if we go back to where we started, is we don't want too much tendon stiffness and we don't want too little tendon stiffness. There seems to be this really nice place for tendon stiffness. So I'm still not clear about the relationship about AGEs, tendon stiffness and pathology or pain, but it's definitely a factor. And smoking's a factor as well. Our lifestyle related diseases definitely contribute outside of a mechanical effect. So everyone says, oh, you're just heavier, therefore you're loading your tendon more. That's not it. It's definitely more than that. Whether it's AGEs, whether it's this low-grade systemic inflammation, I don't think we fully understand what it is.
Okay. And by that token, I'm imagining the evidence isn't at the point yet that we know exactly the functional implications. And then even further than that, if we were to have an impact on some of these variables like body mass index, or if, you know, medical management of diabetes, if there's any change in these outcomes or correlations as well, right?
Yep. Nobody's done that study. That study's sitting there. That's been in my brain for about 20 years. And fantastic if somebody wanted to pick it up. But bariatric medicine is the way to go. Measure people's tendons before their bariatric surgery, get them to lose a whole heap of weight, see what happens to their tendons afterwards. That would be so interesting. I don't know that anybody's done any good studies in the super morbidly obese and their tendon health. I mean, they're a really interesting group because they're not loading very much, but they have all of this systemic inflammatory, you know, AGEs, whatever you want to call it, response. Does that affect tendons? I don't think we know. I don't think the research there is there. What we do know is you change these things, people get better. And one of our clinical strategies is to really address this as part of our overall treatment, that we really like people to try and become a normal body, have a normal body weight. We try and make sure as best we can that they control these comorbidities. But you can't always do that.
Yeah, and just from my perspective, that intrigues me. So like, what avenues do you take to explore those topics with your patients?
Yeah, that's a really interesting thing. I think you, probably harder in the US than Australia. We tend to be fairly direct here. because we run what we call our desperate and dateless practice. So we see people that have had multiple years of and multiple interventions. So really complex long-term tendon problems. It's very easy to address that in that situation. You know, you've tried all of these things, they haven't worked, your rehab hasn't been particularly good, these are things we're going to try, but you actually have to lose weight as well. And by that stage, people are ready to really try anything. I think it's much harder at a primary contact level when someone who first presents it. You have to go through the education process, and education is such an important part of how we manage tendons. What happens, why other things haven't worked, what you need to do about what we're trying to achieve, how long it's going to be, what things will influence your outcome. And I think that's a really good way to start. There are things that will influence your outcome, and that is related to your body weight, and then just park it there and leave them to make a decision about whether they consider that to be an important thing to change.
You know, that's good. That's definitely a conversation I struggle to have with my patients. So I'm glad to get your insight on that.
Mm. I'm not sure it's effective for everybody. And there are people who will be morbidly offended by you having that conversation. But it's the reality. You know, you don't tiptoe around other things. For me, you don't sort of, you know, not tell people things that are having an effect on the outcome and having an effect on their long-term health, tendon health. I'm not talking about general health because I don't think we have the right to do that. But their long-term tendon health can be improved if they had a normal body weight and they had their diabetes under control. I think that's quite reasonable.
Yeah, great. The last factor I want to kind of talk about, and this is something I definitely haven't looked at that much of, but I've seen one-off studies here and there looking at maybe genetic determinants behind some predispositions for tendinopathy. I mean, is this something you've looked into at all? Is there certain predispositions that may be heritable when it comes to this?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is Malcolm Collins, Allison September's work, and we've collaborated with them. There is definitely one gene that type 5 collagen anyway, COL5A1 gene, the COL5A1 gene. It's associated with tendinopathy. And even if you listen to Malcolm Collins talk about this, he doesn't believe that there's any role for screening for it, because what are you going to do? If you find that you have the TT allele for type 5 collagen, are you going to counsel those people not to be active? Are you going to counsel these people to be more active? You could counsel them until you're blue in the face and they'll never develop a tendon pathology. You could counsel them until they're blue, you're blue in the face and they'll develop a tendon pathology, but they'll never develop pain. So to put it in a perspective that's more obvious, I was at a conference last year and they were talking about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and this can kill you if you continue to play sport. And the perspective from that conference was, you have the right to tell people they have this gene. You have the right to tell people that if they continue to exercise, that they could die. But you don't have the right to tell them not to exercise. And, you know, if we put that in a tendon perspective, we're so far away from having any ability to counsel these people in any meaningful way that it's a pointless exercise. So I don't think there's a role for it at all.
Access to healthcare is one of the largest issues facing both providers and patients, as millions of people worldwide lack timely and affordable access to healthcare. Anywhere Healthcare, a telehealth platform, is a simple, low-cost option for providers and patients that eliminates the barriers to access to all kinds of healthcare. To find out more, check out anywhere.healthcare, which is available in our show notes. And if you use the code HET in all caps when you email to sign up, you'll save 25% off the total cost.
Thank you for attending class today, and we hope that you learned something and gained value from the content.
If you'd like to schedule office hours with us, feel free to add us on Twitter at HET Podcast, on Instagram, HET Podcast, on Facebook, The Healthcare Education Transformation Podcast, and the homepage, healthcareeducationtransformationpodcast.com.
And for those of you following along in the syllabus, extra credit can be obtained by liking us, sharing us, and leaving a review.
Let's continue our journey up Mount Educational Success as lifelong learners.